recognized that it was in your own life, that's when you repented of it, didn't you? How many of you are old now? You're over the age of 12. If you're over the age of 12, you should have identified certain things in your life that you were a part of. And only by way of continually facing the same circumstances, you one day said, I can't do this anymore. I do not choose it. This is bad. This is destructive. This is evil. Some of you have an attitude about things that you have recently repented over. Why? Because you were faced with it over and over again. You begin to see it in other folks. You said, oh, my Lord, that's in me. And then you began to affirm, yes, it was in me. And you had to repent from it. Why did you repent? Because you did not want that in your life. You saw and you knew and you understood that was not of your Father, and you repented. See, if he had not had you in that place, you wouldn't have chosen light over that darkness. Do you not know that all these things in this world is about your choice? With every time you repent, it's because you understand that it is darkness, and then you want no part of it. Every single soul on the face of this earth has an appointed time for all those things that are mandated upon us: repentance, coming to the Lord, choosing darkness and light, right? Choosing the Father's way over our ways, no matter what it looks like. Even walking by faith. You have to grow to fully walk by faith. You're not going to automatically do it. But if you're thinking in terms of winning and losing, you're going to try and escape the learning process straight to the victory, like a kid that goes to class and says, I don't want to go to class. I just want to graduate. I don't want to take the exams. I want to graduate. I don't want to study, right? Because the process in between your first day of school and graduation, it's a lot of stuff in between. People say, well, this test is unfair. This teacher's unfair. This stuff is unfair. Well, they have all sorts of arguments and complaints. Yet when they graduate, they all say the same thing. Phew, I did it. And they're kind of proud they graduated. Yet they complain the entire time. Why is that? Because they had little understanding of the process of school in the first place. How many of you later on in life, I mean honestly, you said, well, I wish I would have studied harder in school, because you faced something you blew off at school as an adult, and it caused you to say to yourselves, I wish I wouldn't have played around in school and really listened and learned this subject, because now I see it again and I don't know it. Now it's a hindrance in my life. How many have ever said that? Because the truth is, later on, you begin to realize things. You realize how much you needed of this, that, and the other. But while you were going through it, you resisted the training. You resisted the process of growth. With trials and tribulations, often we resist. When that boat was rocking and rolling in the storm, they acknowledged that Jesus was Jesus, but they were frightened in the storm as though they were going to die, as though the forces of nature were going to take them over. Yet, they were disciples of Christ. They couldn't even, and then when he walked in the water, it scared them. They thought it was a ghost. Why? Because they had not yet gone through the full process. See, when they became apostles, they did not walk like they did when they were disciples. Why? Did you notice when they were disciples, they were learning? Yes. But they were also later on confronted with real questions. Remember when Jesus came to the disciples, to Peter, and he said, Peter, do you love me? Peter said, yes. He said, well, feed my sheep. But Peter had already established his love for Christ. But there's always a point when Jesus and when the Father will confront you with a choice after you're educated to the difference between the two sides. He will never give you a choice that you have no understanding of. Never. He will always ensure that you have understanding. He'll make it known to you first to give you a choice. Now, some of you who have these issues and things going on in your life, yes, you're being fortified, but there's a choice coming for you, because the Lord will have you understand the choice before you make it. You guys remember that time when you chose Christ for real? When you had a full understanding of who Christ was? Now, everybody has not had that yet. Some of you went through the motions, and you know you still had that other time that was the time. You guys remember that? You went to the altar, you were saved, but then there was that one time when the truth of who Christ was hit you to the core. But it was after the moment you had gone to the altar and gave your life to Christ. So you did it before men, but then there was that one time by yourself that you understood. In your life, God is presenting you darkness and light. And he's saying, which one do you choose? Because any child that's truly his truly wants the light and not the darkness. When you're going through your life, don't compete. Why would you compete when the Lord sent you here for very specific reasons of his own? You don't have to compete. And obedience is better than sacrifice. But you learn obedience through sufferings, trials, and tribulations. Why? Because obedience, listen, obedience is not force. Do you know that? Obedience is choosing light over darkness. Do you know that? Obedience to the world when they start using animals and everything else, that is forced obedience. That is what Satan does. God doesn't do that. God will have you understand, he'll make you qualified to choose between darkness and light, so that when you are obedient, it's not that you were forced to obey. See, if you have to force obedience with the Lord, how can you belong to him? Obedience with the Lord comes by way of a choice and a desire to continue to follow the light and not the darkness. Melchizedek, Christ, they learn obedience through sufferings. The Bible says so. I didn't just make that up. And sufferings, we know, are trials and tribulations, troubles, and resistance in your life. They learned. They went through the process. This is a biblical principle God established from the beginning that's been lost over time. Because now people want to win. They want to be victorious. And when they're not victorious and they don't win, they feel like losers. Not understanding that this process has nothing to do with winning and losing. It has everything to do with honestly choosing. No, I did not mean to make that rhyme. It just popped out that way. This entire process that you're in, do you know what you're doing? You're choosing either your Father in heaven and the things of your Father, or you're choosing darkness. The alternative light of the world is darkness. That means you're being educated about the truth of darkness and light, and you are making a choice for you. When you choose the light over the darkness in the small things, that's when you have a victory internally. Not getting rich in the world, not having all your enemies die, but when you choose the light over the darkness, finally, that's when you have the victory. That's when you're victorious. Do you all see that? That's what many people are missing. They want other people to see their victory. It's not about that. Listen, when there was a day that something kept coming to me, and I would fall prey to it. One day I didn't. That was my day of a victory. Nobody else knew, nor could perceive if I had that victory or not. But I did. I said, thank you, Lord. I did not. I thank you. I was just so thankful. That charged me up to be able to choose light over darkness and to continue to have that desire for the light, not the darkness. That's the victory of the saints. See, because when we ultimately choose in many things of this world, light or the darkness will truly belong to him. I'll say it again. God's children, his true children, will never choose darkness. Now, I'm saying that because you grew up in sin, because you did not know what darkness truly was. You thought you did, but you didn't. Many who are, they have understanding, they're getting older, they know what darkness is now. Darkness looks like love. Darkness looks like romance. Darkness looks like a promise. Darkness can look like anything. But we're finding out all too often, I don't want it. And in that sole choice of choosing light over the darkness in small areas with your process of growth, that's your victory. It's an unseen victory. Now when Jesus comes back, that will be a victory that everybody will see. But you're not living a competition. You're not here to have the world look at you and say, oh, they're just winning in the philosophies of this world. No, because your Father in heaven does not want you to operate your life based upon philosophies of the world. And again, most don't know what that word philosophy implies. But a philosophy of the world or doctrine, they don't know what that implies. applies because what they're doing is living by this philosophy of winning and losing in the world and trying to follow or walk by the word of God at the same time. It does not work. If we were looking at winning and losing, well, then that means Ezekiel lost, Isaiah lost, Jeremiah lost, didn't they? Did they tell the whole nation, or did they tell just a few? The Lord was very specific. People didn't celebrate the prophets back then. The prophets have a time reserved for them when they will be celebrated. The prophets were spit on. Is that a victory? The prophets were rejected. Is that a victory? What about the apostles? Did they sit in castles? Big cathedrals? No, they didn't. They were hunted down like dogs, resisted at every corner. Every work or foundation they laid out, somebody sought to dig it up and take it down and kill it. Is that a victory in the world? No, it isn't. Now let me ask you this. What if you're called of the Lord, what makes you think your life is going to be any different? But see, you're not called to have your mind in the world. Better for those who had a hard life now than to have an easy life and face what's coming in their tomorrows. That philosophy of winning and losing, that the world functions and operates by in everything, not in some things, in everything, should never be among the saints. Our victory is that through Christ Jesus. Now, what happens when you have the true victory over darkness? When you choose light over darkness? When out of your heart you do not desire darkness, you're choosing the light. Let me tell you what happens when it's a choice of yours. Now, a choice, in order to make a true choice with the Father, you must be presented with truth. He's not a trickster, which means the truth of darkness and the truth of light will be set before you, and he will say, choose. But when you choose him, guess what happens? For every portion that he exposes in your life, where you choose him in it, guess what happens? That area of your life is then part of the kingdom of God. Do you know that? That's why it states that the kingdom of God is within you. It is born in you. No one's going to say, here it is, or lo, there it is, which means it is kept away from the world. No one has tainted it, but it is born within you. So what happens when it increases within you? Then all the principles and the authorities of the kingdom are increased within you. Then you come to a fullness, walking in this earth with power and authority of the kingdom of God. But it's all based upon him and nothing. It is, can't you see, it has nothing. Man cannot do this for you, because only God can present to you the truth of darkness and light. People are trying to go out there and find what somebody else wrote about darkness and light. That's what trials and tribulations are for. He did never once said that he's going to send a person to put you through trials and tribulations. No, God orchestrates this in your life according to the calling and according to who he sent you here to be. Your Father in heaven is doing this. He does this because he is the only one that knows exactly how to reach you in all areas. And his work is a perfect work in your life. And he will put before you darkness and light at an appointed time, his appointed time. And when you choose, I'm telling you now, when he presents it, that's when darkness makes you sick. If a person had been doing something all their lives, if God were to present to them darkness and light, and they were a child of the living God, all of their darkness would make them sick. They would repent and choose light. Because when he presents the truth, after you have operated in that stuff, when he presents it, a few things happen. Number one, because you have tasted of it, and you know you took it in, you'll never brag how you overcame anything, because you'll know that you fell prey to it. But you'll also know it is darkness. And if you have a desire for your Lord over this world, that darkness is going to make you sick. Then you begin to repent, because you feel you have offended your Father in heaven. You have fallen short greatly. You see the truth of your situation. You begin to quote scripture, even if you don't know the scripture. You'll say, Lord, I messed up big time. Please forgive me for this. But see, in your heart will be a true repentance. I mean that repentance is turning away from never doing again. I mean, if it were to cost you your life, you still wouldn't go back to that darkness. And in so doing, out of your love for the Lord, out of a deep reverence and respect for God Almighty, you would choose to obey the Lord by way of love, not being forced. God does not force anybody to conform, but he will present you with the truth of darkness and light. And when you're presented with the truth of darkness and light, you'll make a decision based upon the truth of you. If you're one of those who are twice plucked up by the roots, clouds without water, spots and feasts of charities, you're going to continue to choose darkness when God presents you with a choice of darkness and light. But if you belong to the Lord, your dark, that darkness you were part of, you're going to see it for real. You're going to remember what you did in it. Your flesh is going to be guilty as charged, and your flesh is going to shut up and go sit down. It will have nothing to say. Spiritually, you'll stand up and repent, turn away from it, and in that moment when you repent, the strength will be added to you to maintain that repentance. Do you not know that every time you repent, it is Christ in you that maintains the strength? He maintains that strength that you may endure or keep that repentance with you the entire time. It's not you. God presents you with a choice. Once you choose, if you choose the light, it is the strength of Christ that sustains you. Do you know that? When you're on your own, it requires your strength. But we are to love the Lord our God with all of our strength. And if you're one of his children, that's exactly what you're going to do. Which means you will choose the light, but it is the strength of Christ that sustains even your repentance. Because he begins to guard your mind, and Satan will never win again. But your trials and tribulations, those tests and troubles in your life, they expose what? Us. They are a gauge. On one side is full, on the other side is empty. And from that gauge, you can see exactly where you are. Remember, God does not lie, nor does he deceive. He wants us to have the truth. He can offer nothing but the truth. So when he shows us who we are, he's going to show us the truth. And our trials and tribulations establish exactly where we are. See, it's not about being on full all the time, jumping over everything. And if a trial comes, don't cry. You're going to be delivered. You need to first think about, wait a minute, it's a trial. I'm in trouble here. Lord, what are you showing me? I'm telling you, if you would approach it by the standards of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus of Nazareth, your life wouldn't be different. You wouldn't curse your life. A man only curses his life when he has no understanding of his life. Any trouble that comes into your life, any trouble, is not against you. It is for you. That's your Father in heaven's way of presenting to you something. And it's time for us to look. It's a gauge upon us. When a hardship comes upon your life, it's exposing something of us. It is for us. Don't think about anybody else. Think about yourself and say, wait a minute, why am I being affected by this? When the Lord said, I shall not be moved, surely I have a weakness, Lord, show me. I'm listening. Because in every case in the Bible, when somebody was afraid, the Father and Jesus said the same thing. Fear not. Don't let your heart be troubled. He gave the same thing every single time, and he gave instruction afterward, which basically states, endure it. I'm working with you. But see, that's not like the world, is it? See, with the world, they empower mankind to get themselves out of trouble. They teach a different philosophy. And if you're found perfect in the world, you're found acceptable and worthy of a type of glory that's in the world, but with the Lord. On a daily basis, he's presenting us with darkness and light because you're royalty in training. And you're choosing him or darkness every single moment of your life. And stop thinking in terms of failure and start looking at these things as a gauge. They let you know exactly where you are. They let you know the truth of you. It is a reflection of you. When a trouble comes in your life, why is it a trouble? What part in you is still flesh that would be a trouble? That's why you see Peter being crucified. And what does he do? Hang me upside down. That's why you see Stephen being stoned to death. Skull cracked and everything else. And what does he do? Father, lay not this sin to their charge. I tell you now, they didn't perceive trouble like we do. They did not perceive their trouble. But what they did was that they perceived the truth. And when you perceive truth over trouble, there's only one way that can happen, and that's when Christ is fully within you. See, because every time you repent, reject darkness, the kingdom grows within you. The only way to reject darkness is to embrace the truth and the light of our Father.